Recording is on.
Okay, I think we're good to go. So welcome everyone to this month's Journal Club, and it's my pleasure to introduce our two speakers of today, Dr. Cristina Kifaldi and Dr. Beatrice Riolta. Cristina obtained a PhD in 2016, and she has been has performed a postdoc afterwards at the Bambino Gesù Children's Hospital. And since 2020, she stayed there as a research biologist and is actually a PI of the 5-XMeal project studying immunodysregulation and EBV responses in APDS and APDS-like patients, focusing on the study of of modulation through specific inhibitors. And our second speaker of today is Dr. Beatrice Riolta. She's a physician and she obtained her medical degree in 2013 from the University of Bologna. She performed a residence in pediatrics afterwards and is now a PhD student at the University of Tor Vergata in Rome and is also a research fellow in the research unit of primary immunodeficiencies. And today the two are going to talk about their joint publication studying a cohort of RUC deficient patients that was published last year in the Journal of Clinical Immunology. If you have any questions that come up during the talk, feel free to write them in the chat so that the two can answer them after the talk. And with this, you can start your presentation.
Thank you, Annalena. Okay. Recombination activating gene 1 and 2 encode lymphoid-specific proteins that are involved in early phase of T and B cell development. These proteins form a heterotetrameric complex that initiate VDJ recombination through generating a DNA double simplex at the recombination signal sequences that flank the variable diversity and joining segments of immunoglobulin and TCR gene. Then these DNA double simplex are joined by the ubiquitous machinery or non-homologous joining, and as a result of this process, we have a polyclonal pool of functional T and B cell lymphocytes expressing a diversified repertoire of antigen-specific receptor able to recognize a million possible antigens, so answering the plasticity of adaptive immune system. RUC deficiency is associated to a wide range of clinical and immunological manifestation, but at variance with other PID gene, in which a common phenomenon may underline the presence of loss of function and gain of function of G allele, RUC deficiency underlies a continuum degree of residual recombination activity and translate in continuum degree of impairment of T and B cell lymphocytes, their diversity, composition, and homeostasis. Historically, RUC deficiency have been associated to a severe combined immunodeficiency phenotype in which patients are prone to infection since early life that lead to death without hematopoietic stem cell transplantation. These patients also present with the absence of B and T cell lymphocytes and affected family member. We know now that hypomorphic mutation could lead to different type of clinical immunological manifestation. For example, very low residual recombination activity is associated to a Noonan syndrome phenotype in which patients are characterized by the squamating erythroderma, lymphoproliferation, hepatosplenomegaly, and recurrent pneumonia. Moreover, they present with the absence of B cells, with hypogamma globulinemia, but elevated IgE serum level, eosinophilia, and the presence of autologous oligoclonal autoreactive T cells. Moreover, a greater residual recombination activity could be associated to leaky SCID or atypical SCID phenotype. This phenotype related to a different degree of detectable albeit reduced T and B cell lymphocytes, with particularly the expansion for some patients of T cell expressing gamma delta TCR, particularly after a cytomegalovirus infection or lymphoproliferative disease, EBV related. Last, the greatest residual recombination activity could be associated to a combined immunodeficiency with the granuloma and autoimmunity. In this case, the patient present in different number T and B cell lymphocytes and different level of immunoglobulin. In some cases with IBR gamma, they present also immune dysregulation and in some cases malignancies. They are also prone to herpes viride infection. So if we have an early onset phenotype with a severe infection related to null or very low recombination activity, on the other hand, we see a delayed onset phenotype even in childhood related to an immune dysregulation associated to a greater residual recombination activity. But we have to say that sometimes the genotype-phenotype correlation is not so obvious, particularly due to the presence of environmental factors such as virus, chronic and uncontrolled virus infection that may modify the course of disease beside the level of residual recombination activity even within the members of the same family. This is the common assay used to quantify the residual recombination activity in which pro-B cells, transformed pro-B cells with the GFP inverted cassette flanked by the residual with the recombination signal sequences are transfected either with wild type or mutated RAG gene. The fluorescent signal that we see in human wild type and mouse wild type RAG gene derived from the occurrence of recombination. But we can see different degree of residual recombination activity, for example, a greater residual recombination in CID to a very low or null recombination activity to a severe phenotype. And this different degree of recombination activity translate in a different degree of diversity and clonality of immunoglobuli and TCR receptor. For example, we can see a decrease of diversity and an increase of clonality when we move from mild phenotype to severe phenotype. In this case, for example, Omenn syndrome shows the very low diversity but an increase in clonality. We also know that infection represent the main manifestation, main symptom of onset of the disease and the main complication for some RAG patient. But recently, different reports show that also autoimmunity could represent the main symptom at onset manifestation, particularly triggered by the viral infection that could closely precede the onset of the disease. As for example, described by Farmer et al. In this paper, in which 85 CORT or RAG deficient patients are reviewed for the presence or the absence of autoimmunity. We can see different types of autoimmune manifestations such as cytopenia, granuloma, skin disease, nephropathy and others affecting particularly CID group or atypical SCID group. Moreover, both in the reviewed published cases and in the CORT of Farmer et al. Of 63 patients, we can see that cytopenia could be the main manifestation of autoimmunity. And this underline could be sustained by a break of central and peripheral tolerance for both T and B cells. Now we describe our retrospective analysis of our CORT.
Okay, between 2009 and 2020, so in 11 years, we diagnosed 22 RAG patients at Bambino Gesù Children's Hospital. The majority of patients, 8 cases, were diagnosed as SCID in 2 cases with maternity engraftment, 6 patients as Omenn syndrome, 4 as leaky atypical SCID, and 4 as CID. The median age at the onset of the symptoms and genetic diagnosis was lower in SCID and Omenn syndrome than in leaky atypical SCID and mostly in CID. The median time between the onset of symptoms and genetic diagnosis was 75 days in SCID, 1 month for Omenn syndrome, 14 months for leaky atypical SCID, and 3 years for CID patients. This is explained by the difficulty in recognizing CID patients with hypomorphic regmutation that show milder symptoms, less specific, and later in life than severe combined immunodeficiency. Among CID patients, in 2 cases, the delay was particularly long. One patient has shown a mild clinical phenotype with upper respiratory infection, well controlled by the immunoglobulin substitutive therapy and no other complication. And so it was difficult to suspect the kind of inborn error of immunity. The other case developed a refractory chronic hemolytic anemia, previously followed in another hospital with less experience in inborn error of immunity. And she was referred to our hospital after 2 years with steroids and other therapies that can't control the symptoms. So especially between CID patients and previous undiagnosed cases, an increased number of diagnoses of FRAG deficiency were performed thanks to the application of next generation sequencing technologies. After the application, the number of diagnoses increased from a median of 1.5 up to 2.6 for years. As we will say later, to avoid a severe complication is important to think about this kind of inborn error of immunity in order to treat and prevent the infection and other comorbidities related to toxicity of therapy, and also perform transplantation as early as possible when we think that is indicated. The main symptom at the presentation was infection observed in 18 patients. During follow-up, especially patients with SCID developed the respiratory and upper and lower respiratory and gastrointestinal infection, but also chronic viremia, in particular a herpes virus, so CMV and EBV, but also adenovirus, were common among our cohort. Chronic viremia were detected in 4 SCID patients, in 1 Omenn syndrome, in 3 leaky atypical SCID, and 4 CID. 2 SCID and 1 Omenn syndrome were early diagnosis, thanks to the prenatal diagnosis, and also because they have a strongly suggestive phenotype that permitted to diagnose them and perform the transplantation early with no complication associated with the treatment. 50 out of 20 patients present autoimmune and or hyperinflammatory manifestation, especially dermatitis occurred in 9 patients, representing the onset manifestation in all Omenn syndrome, in 2 leaky atypical SCID, and in 2 SCID patients. Lymphoproliferation and splenomegaly were found in 4 patients. Some patients developed also other particular immunodysregulation manifestation as nephropathy, found in 2 patients, but also a neurological involvement as Miller-Fisher syndrome in a patient with a prolonged CMV infection. It's important to underline that infection, autoimmunity, and immune dysregulation manifestation occurred together in more than half of cases in 12 patients, highlighting the impact of the environmental factor as infection on the clinical phenotype. Moreover, this atypical manifestation as dermatitis, cytopenia, nephritis, vitiligo, or other stuff can be the main and the first symptoms, and this can lead to the patients to the attention of other specialists with less experience in inborn error of immunity. And so it's important to work in a multidisciplinary team to diagnose and treat these patients. between autoimmune inflammatory complication, 5 patients, 1 Omenn syndrome and 1 leaky atypical SCID and 3 CID, develop a severe and refractory cytopenia with a median age of at the onset of 1 year, so really early in life. These cytopenia were refractory to conventional first-line treatment, such as steroids and immunoglobulin therapies, but also to other therapies as mycophenolate, rapamycin, and plasmapheresis. 2 patients with cytopenia resolved their cytopenia thanks to transplantation. 1 dead before the transplantation and another 1 dead after the transplantation, but due to an infection. The last patients with CID phenotype and are refractory anemia developed too many complications such as obesity, hypertension, oppressive syndrome, diabetes, and diffuse thrombosis, and was considered not eligible for transplantation. For this reason, it's important to diagnose this patient and treat in a better way to make possible transplantation when a donor is available.
About the genetic findings, we found 19 RAG1 mutation and 3 RAG2 mutation. We also found 9 out of 20 family with the consanguinity, in which we found a homozygous mutation, and then we detect 3 novel mutation in RAG1 and 2 mutation in RAG2. About the novel mutation, the first one carried by the PDATE fall in non-number banding domain. Mutation that fall in this domain have been described related to a very low to null residual recombination activity. And in this case, this could match perfectly with the SCID phenotype observed in our patient. The second novel mutation carried by the PID4 result in a truncated protein. The mutation that fall in the ring domain have been associated to an impaired protein localization and chromatin accessibility. But in this case, the truncated protein probably may affect heavily the residual recombination activity. Last, the mutation carried by the PID22 fall in C-terminus domain, and in this case, the mutation that fall in this domain have been associated to a different degree of residual recombination activity, and this could explain the CID phenotype of PID22. About the novel RAG2 mutation carried by the PID12, both fall in the catalytic core RAG2 protein. In this case, the truncated protein by the second mutation heavily affect the residual recombination activity and could lead to a Omenn syndrome phenotype that we observed in PID12.
As expected, increased IgE levels were observed in all Omenn syndrome patients. In SCID and Omenn syndrome group, IgA and IgM resulted low, whereas IgG reflected the maternal transplacental transfer. The typical SCID and CID group showed normal immunoglobulin values, except for 1 patient with leaky atypical SCID who manifested hypergammaglobulinemia. Circulating T cells were absent or particularly low in all SCID patients, except for infants with maternal T cell engraftment, where CD3, CD4, and CD8 positive cell count were higher in Omenn syndrome group. In leaky atypical SCID and CID group, T cell number was reduced, in particular in naive T cells, with a proportional expansion of CD45 raw positive cells. As previously reported in literature in other patients, expansion of gamma delta T cells was found in 2 leaky atypical SCID patients with a persistent CMV infection. Circulating B cells were nearly absent in all SCID and Omenn syndrome patients, in line with their IgA and IgM values, and variable in atypical SCID and CID patients. NK cells were present in all group with normal or increased number, especially in SCID group. Among with 15 patients with autoimmune hyperinflammatory manifestation. Transplantation was performed in 12 patients at an older age respect to patients without autoimmunity and immune dysregulation. This is partially due to the diagnostic delay that is related to the initial mild phenotype, but also to the later onset of these patients. Between patients with autoimmune cytopenia, two resolved their cytopenia and another one died for the infection. More than half of patients were transplanted by a haploid identical familiar donor. The overall survival was really good with 94%, so with a median follow-up of 61 months. All patients transplanted for now show normal immunoglobulin values. In two patients occurred graft failure, but it was rescued by an allograft from the other parent. Three patients developed an acute mild cutaneous graft versus host disease, and no other acute, more severe acute or chronic GVHD were reported. 90 patients show infection complication after the transplant. 5 bloodstream infection, some patients viral reactivation, especially CMV in 6 patients, herpes virus 6 in 2 patients, and adenovirus in 4. 3 patients develop infectious enteritis, and 1 died for invasive pulmonary aspergillosis that was present also before the transplantation. 2 patients, one with autoimmune cytopenia, died before transplantation due to multi-organ failure in course of infection. As we have already said, one sick patient was considered not eligible for the transplantation due to the comorbidities developing during the follow-up related to therapy and infection. In conclusion, RAG deficiency still presents a challenge in tracing effective management and follow-up, considering the inability to predict the disease course, especially in patients with hypomorphic mutation and atypical presentation. Our cohort highlighted the heterogeneity of manifestation associated with inborn error of immunity, particularly inborn error of immunity with hypomorphic mutation and milder phenotype. The genotype-phenotype correlation in RAG deficiency is not absolute. Other factor beyond the level of recombination activity as an infection may influence the clinical phenotype, even in the same family. Our data show that in RAG deficiency, immune dysregulation manifestations are frequent, presented by more than half our patients in our cohort. Especially dermatitis and refractory cytopenia, often resistant to conventional treatment. Otherwise, atypical immune dysregulation manifestations, such as nephritis or neurological manifestation, could represent the first or the main onset symptom. And this manifestation can lead patients to the attention of other specialists with less experience in inborn error of immunity and delaying the correct diagnosis. So it's important to work in a multidisciplinary team also with biologists in order to early recognize this manifestation and these patients and give a good treatment as well as hematopoietic stem cell transplantation and prevent the onset of complication or infection that can also compromise the transplantation in a second time. Extending RAG analysis to older pediatric and adult patients affected by undefined inborn error of immunity as well as CVD with immune dysregulation manifestation may help discover novel cases and expand the current knowledge of natural history or RAG deficiency, improving the diagnostic and clinical management of this cohort of patients. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I will just stop the recording before we can move to the questions.